Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Astute Law Listen Up podcast. And I have the pleasure of having Jamie.Lester, partner from Hamlins, back with us again. How are you doing, Jamie?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm good. You know, this was a particularly interesting topic in terms of it being current and perhaps really relevant for businesses, employers. And I just wanted to, you know, what we're doing with these podcasts, Jamie, we're generally trying to put some good out there for businesses, employers and employees, in fact, in different ways, not just employment law. And we're looking at ways that they can understand the value of different types of conduct or behavior or things that they could do that perhaps they didn't even know about. So today's topic, I think, might be useful for a lot of people that might not be aware of what we're talking about, which deals with the business interruption and insurance cover. Before we get into that, Jamie, tell us a little bit about yourself, your firm. You know, why should anybody listening to this podcast be listening to you about this type of topic?
It's interesting because the firm is historically, by the way, if I look down, it's because I've got a couple of notes here. Referring to as part of our conversation. But yeah, the firm acts for a lot of restaurants and hotel and leisure groups who have personally been affected by the pandemic. So we've been asked to advise quite a few clients on business interruption. So, and the ability to make claims. And a lot of clients have struggled to make a claim. So they've come to us on quite an urgent basis and said, what can we do?
Okay, so let's get into it. What is the business interruption you're referring to? What is the insurance cover that people should be having in place, or they already have in place, they don't know about it?
Well, I'm sure that this is not new news to most people, because the COVID pandemic has had quite a devastating impact on UK businesses. In fact, actually, other than an online community such as Netflix, Amazon, Deliveroo, or those businesses that have a dedicated online offering, and are able to pivot, most of the sectors in the British industry have been affected. In fact, the high street, fashion, leisure, restaurant, travel and events industries have been decimated.
Yes.
So it's hard to know how long it will take for these businesses to recover. The economy generally is in a bad state, although, of course, there's confidence with the news that restrictions are hopefully going to be eased in the coming months. But at the moment, unemployment is currently sitting at about 5.1%, which is really high.
Yeah,
but actually most businesses would have taken out business interruption insurance as part of their general business insurance packages. They would have done this either directly through their insurers or via brokers. And I can talk more about the distinction a bit later on.
Jamie, let me get into that. So when we're talking about COVID being covered by insurance or these sorts of situations, aren't they get out clauses? Like, isn't this like an act of God or something like that?
No, it's not an act of God. That's more like a kind of force majeure clause.
Yeah.
Where you have say somebody has an event and or you're meant to deliver something, but you can't deliver it because of a government action. And that would be a force majeure hit in these cases. And in fact, actually, we've had to advise clients on that as well, because there's been clients who were meant to be doing large events over the coming months who aren't able to do so because the government haven't allowed them to actually meet in person. Yes. You're not allowed to have large gatherings of people. So again, there are those kind of clauses, but that's more force majeure. That's not a business interruption clause.
Yes.
Business interruption insurance is there to cover a business where they are forced to close due to a government action or due to a disease or a notifiable disease. The problem's been that a lot of clients who have been trying to, as I said earlier, who have been trying to bring a claim have had trouble getting their claims approved or paid out because of the wording. Because this is a new disease. Okay, this is not a disease that has been out there before. So there's the interpretation of the disease and some of the clauses that are in there want a notifiable disease. They also, a lot of the clauses that you see specify a specific radius of where a notifiable disease has had to occur. So you see a lot of them where you're covered for incidences of a notifiable disease within 25 miles of your premises.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of access to that. You also have to have there's also issues on interpretation about prevention of access. So, you know, losses as a result of a public authority coming in and preventing access. And then you've also got hybrid clauses, which are between notifiable diseases and prevention of access clauses. So it's quite a quandary for people. And they also then have the issue of trying to show the link, the causation link, between the business interruption loss and the occurrence of the notifiable disease.
Yeah.
So actually quite interestingly, for the first time in a long time, the Financial Conduct Authority took the ball by the horns, basically, and decided they weren't going to just allow this to stay because the whole nation were in trouble, and decided to actually take commence test proceedings last year. And they did it in conjunction with 8 leading insurers to try and clarify whether a variety of the policy wordings covered business interruption. Of course, these insurers were quite happy to do this because they actually wanted a judgment that came out to say, no, they weren't covered.
Yeah.
But for the rest of us and the rest of the population, it was quite good. And actually, the Supreme Court gave a decision actually early this year in January. I don't know how detailed to give it, but actually what it covered, which was quite interesting, was the basically they said that the Supreme Court said that the standard disease clause would cover business interruption losses because it was made a notifiable disease on the 5th of March, i.e. the government clarified that COVID was a notifiable disease. But they had to be able to prove that there was at least one occurrence of the disease within the defined geographical area. So in London, it's quite easy, or in quite a few of the cities around the country, it's going to be quite easy to show that there's been one instance of a COVID-related disease or illness within a 25-mile radius.
Yes.
In relation to what we call prevention of access and hybrid clauses, which normally specify a series of requirements which have to be met before the insurer will pay, some of the clauses specify that where there were restrictions imposed by a public authority following a court, an occurrence of a notifiable disease, that's what you need. But what the court held was that an instruction given by a public authority in clear terms is basically is causation. Actually, that would actually be good enough. In addition, the Prime Minister's general instructions via his addresses to the nation would also cover this. They also held that where policy wording provides cover for only where a business interruption loss is caused by an inability to use the premises, this is actually a complete inability. Okay, so it can't be just like, so in other words, where a good example is a restaurant. So where a restaurant is now able to offer a takeaway service, whereas before it was able to offer takeaway and eat in, it can't claim for the period that it's offering the takeaway. It can only claim for the period that it's completely shut. So that's quite an important thing. The last issue
is going to be that way, Jamie. When they're always going to the court rulings in favour of businesses in those circumstances and not let the insurers get away with it. I mean, even recently you probably heard the job retention scheme has been extended again. Now to September is what they're looking at. This year. So they're looking at, they can't just abandon ship. They've got to continually look at ways to prop up businesses, the economy, because if they don't, well, no one can, it's apocalypse. So I guess my question is a couple of things. Would most businesses have these standard kinds of clauses in their contracts if they don't know that already? I suppose the first thing. And if they don't have these things in place, do you know what they can do about it now anyway?
Well, in relation to the first thing you said about government, yes, we've got to remember there's a distinction between the government and the judiciary. The government will go out of their way to try and help businesses because that's what they've already been trying to do for the last year.
Yeah, of course,
the debt that they've built up for doing so is another issue. The judiciary have to take an impartial view and have to look at the way the clauses have been drafted and how they are to be interpreted.
Right.
And it's... And that's where the distinction is. But the courts have to be fair. And, what's interesting here is actually they have been fair. In relation to businesses, if they have business interruption clauses, it's quite easy to get to the bottom of it. You look at what the definition of disease is. You also look at what the definition of infectious diseases is. And then you'll be able to see from there what the main criteria are. And it's quite simple. I mean, the other issue, of course, is whether or not, the causation, whether or not your loss has been caused by the actual public health measures which have been taken to actually try and stem the disease from spreading. And the court here has found that, the relevant measures taken in response to the COVID-19 pandemic were equally effective and proximate causes of that measure. So in other words, all a business needs to show to prove causation is that at the time of any relevant government measure, there was at least one case of COVID within the geographical area covered by their clauses. So the chances are they are going to be able to show it. Yeah. So they've been very, very fair.
Yes, it's quite a low burden. Doesn't help them.
It's a low burden of proof. But what's interesting, of course, is that some insurers over the last few years, where business interruption has been used more and more by businesses, have taken effect and taken steps to try and stem the tide. So what they might have done is they might have specifically defined which diseases or infectious diseases they're prepared to pay out. So
yes.
I was advising a client, say, 2-3 months ago on this, because they unfortunately couldn't bring a claim, even with the Supreme Court judgment, because they specifically defined the diseases they were prepared to pay out on. Okay. Yeah. And that, of course, wouldn't have included COVID, because COVID wasn't even known at the time.
Yeah.
So they couldn't do it. They couldn't bring a claim. So in those circumstances, the way that they could potentially get around it is to say to themselves, well, hang on a second. If you had brokers acting for you, okay, and brokers have advised you year on year, and they've advised you recently to change policies, or they've advised you that this policy is better than that policy, if the previous policy you would have been covered, but the new policy you're not covered, there's a potential claim for negligence against your brokers.
Wow.
But of course, that can only be assessed on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. More fun for lawyers, everyone will be saying, but unfortunately, that's just the case.
So, Jamie, anybody listening to this podcast now, what should they be thinking about? Or what are the next steps they should be doing? Because obviously, your contact details will go out with this podcast.
Yeah.
Anybody that's heard anything here that they want some more clarity on, or some more information on, or some help with it, please reach out to Jamie directly. Can't recommend him enough. Or if you want to go through me, I'll happily put you in touch with each other. But what should they, you know, anybody watching this, what is it that they should be thinking, gosh, I need help with, and I should call Jamie about? What can you do to help them?
Well, it's where automatically the insurers, or you've been informed by your brokers that you just don't have a claim. Okay, or they're refusing to pay out. And even after the Supreme Court judgment, they're just refusing to pay out. Now, if you've got, as I said, if you've got a policy wording which defines specific diseases for which they're going to pay out for, and that won't include COVID, then there's nothing you can do. But in all other circumstances, there's definitely something which is worth looking at. You should be exploring whether, either with your broker or with your insurers, you know, whether or not there is a causal link there. Because if it's a notifiable disease, and if it's to do with measures that have been taken, you should be covered, because you should be able to show the causal link between the shutting of the business and the COVID effect within the X mile radius.
Yeah.
And but you have to also remember that your losses will be the losses for when you have been shut in your entirety. So if you're a business that has been operating and you've been completely closed, that's fine. If you're a business or for a set period of time, that's fine. But if you're a business that's been operating online, okay, well, you're still operating. So it's usually for businesses where they have a premises and those premises have been shut.
Yes, they've just not been able to trade as a result.
Exactly. So that's what to remember. And of course, I hope that helps.
I was about to say exactly that sentence. That's been tremendously helpful. I'm going to call you back again, as you know, in terms of the topics that you kind of cover. You know, I know you have a lot of clients in all sorts of different commercial ways and practical ways as well. Jamie from Hamlins, thank you very much for participating as always. Everybody, thank you for watching, and see you again next time. Bye for now.